Postgres, one of the world's most popular databases. However, due to its monolithic architecture nature, users end up over-provisioning either storage or computing resources. This directly impacts the cost of running Postgres and hinders an application's ability to scale. In this video, let's learn how Neon, an open source company, managed to separate Postgres compute from storage. Let's start with a common problem. You're running a Postgres database and your to-do app starts to grow. What is the solution? You need more processing power? You gotta upgrade the entire instance. You need more storage? Same thing, upgrade everything. You need to run multiple environments? You need to set up separate instances for each environment. To understand why this is the case, we need to first take a look at Postgres architecture and see why it's such a tightly integrated system where compute and storage are inseparable. This starts with the Postmaster, the central process that runs on port 5432. When your application needs to connect to Postgres, the Postmaster creates a dedicated backend process for that connection. This decision, while robust, means each connection consumes significant resources. That's why we have the max connection limit. The real challenge comes from how Postgres manages memory and storage. Postgres uses a shared buffer for caching frequently accessed data, such as index, system catalog, and the actual data itself. This also includes a write-ahead log buffer, or WAL. WAL is essential for keeping data safe and allowing it to recover from crashes. Essentially, how it works is, before making changes to the actual data, Postgres first records them in the WAL, saying, hey, this is what I want to update. This ensures that data is not lost and helps a database recover if something goes wrong, since you can just replay WAL on top of your data. The WAL also supports features like database replication and restoring the database to a specific point in time. On top of that, Postgres runs several critical background processes, from managing logs to writing data and performing maintenance. All these processes must run on the same machine, accessing the same shared buffer and storage. This tight coupling is what makes Postgres architecture monolithic. You can't independently scale compute or storage. Neon reimagined Postgres architecture differently to adapt to modern apps. Rather than running everything on a single machine, Neon split its architecture into two main components. The compute nodes. This is where queries are processed, and it can scale up and down depending on demand, really independent of the storage. And then we have the storage engine. This includes what they call safekeepers and page servers that we'll be going over. This starts with the safekeepers. When you make a change, instead of writing WAL to a single location, it's streamed to multiple independent safekeepers. Safekeepers serve as an ultra-reliable write buffer that holds the latest WAL until it's processed and uploaded to the cloud storage. These safekeepers work together using a consensus algorithm. It's only considered saved when a majority of safekeepers confirm that they've received it. This means that even if some safekeepers fail and goes kaboom, your WAL records remain safe and accessible. It also provides durable storage for recent WAL data until it can be processed further down in the pipeline. And once the safekeepers have confirmed that the WAL record is recorded, the WAL record is then streamed to the page server. The page server is the heart of Neon's storage system. When WAL records arrive at the page server, they're collected in memory buffers. Each WAL change is assigned a monotonically increasing log sequence number, which acts as a timestamp of every change in the database. Once a memory buffer fills up to about 1 GB, the WAL records are written to this as delta layer in the form of immutable files. Think of delta layers as efficient snapshot of changes. They only contains the WAL records within a specific time range. However, having too many delta layers could slow down reads, since each read operation needs to find the latest image layer before the requested log sequence number. We'll go over the image shortly. Search through and apply all relevant changes from each delta layer. If there are too many delta layers, this can really slow down your operation. That's why page servers continuously run a background process called compaction. This process combines multiple delta layers into what they call image layers, complete snapshots of data at specific log sequence number. By reducing the number of delta layers that needs to be processed, compaction helps maintain fast read performance even as your database accumulates changes over time. This means that point-in-time recovery is very easy. Since every change is preserved in immutable files, you can instantly access your database state from any point in time. No time-consuming replay of changes are needed. When a client wants to connect to the database to retrieve their to-do list, Neon automatically connects to a compute node that links to your most recent data. This compute node keeps track of its position in the timeline of changes using the log sequence number. The compute node sends a request to the page server along with the log sequence number. The page server takes the log sequence number to find the most recent image layer containing the data. It then identifies any delta layers that came after and applies the changes to the data before sending it back to the compute node. Everything was going great and your to-do app continues to scale because it's so awesome, until one day, the single page server is on fire and about to explode. Neon addresses this issue by implementing storage sharding by distributing data across multiple page servers. Data is divided into a fixed size chunks called block, where each block is 8 KB in size. To handle large amount of data efficiently, Neon uses something called stripe size to hold these blocks of data. For illustration purposes, we'll say 256 megabytes. When your database size is less than 256 megabytes, all your data can stay in one place. However, as your database grows larger, the system starts distributing these strips into different storage called shards. Suppose there are 8 shards. The system decides where to store each block using a simple formula. You take the block number divided by the strip size, in this case 256 megabytes or 32,768 blocks, and you get 3.052. You hash this result to determine which page server should have the data. This distribution helps balance the load when dealing with large databases. If you have 8 shards, for the best performance, your database should at least be 2 gigabytes in size. This ensures your data is evenly distributed and can be accessed quickly. Currently, every page server subscribes to update from the safekeepers and filtering out what's relevant to them. While this works, Neon is planning to make this more efficient in the future by making safekeepers more aware of which data belongs to which page server. One of the most powerful features that emerged from this architecture redesign is branching. If you ever set up multiple database environments, you know the pain of spinning up new instances, dealing with configuration, managing storage for each environment. It's time-consuming and expensive. Neon's approach to branching leverages their append-only storage system. When you create a new branch, you're not copying any data, you're simply creating a new reference point. Think of it like Git. When you create a new branch in Git, it doesn't duplicate your entire codebase. Instead, it only tracks the changes you made in that branch. To test this, I'm going to write a script to load 10 million random user data to my main branch. It's now done. And let's just make sure that the data exists. We're going to see that branching should be instantaneous, and it should have all our records from our parent branch. Now I'm going to add a new record here on my feature branch. And let's verify that it exists. And now let's verify that it doesn't exist on the main branch. This is awesome. This architecture enables some powerful workflow. Development team can just create a isolated database environments for each feature branch. These are just the high overview of the inner working of Neon's managed service. The work that Neon and the team put together is to help enable easy workflow and take away the pain of running into scaling problems that most teams experience with Postgres. I was able to set up my database and get things running in probably less than a few minutes. Thank you, Neon, for sponsoring this video. If you're curious to learn more about Neon, I'll provide some links in the description. What do you think of their serverless architecture? Thank you again for watching and see you in the next one.